I thought To Live and Die in L.A. was in all about a counterfeit world. Counterfeit emotions. Counterfeit money. Counterfeit superstructure of the Secret Service. Everyone in the film has a kind of counterfeit motive. So it seemed to me that the whole film was about counterfeit relations.
We have never seen L.A., or hadn't at the time, depicted as we see it in this film. This is the L.A. that Billy had come to know. Those streets of East L.A. and the freeways and, the, you know, just that whole world.
Billy is so suited for this movie because Billy is very in touch with the darkness that is in all of us. He's very in touch with the gritty, darker side.
He's very good at finding access to those worlds. There's a weight and an authority about him. When he goes into those worlds, people open up to him. They don't think he's a tourist because they know Billy's heavy and he's serious about what he's doing.
When I read Gerald Petrovich's novel, To Live and Die in L.A., I first thought it's very authentic. What attracted me to it, though, was the absolutely surrealistic nature of the job of a Secret Service man outside of Washington.
Right there, fella!
The Secret Service is under the Treasury. All bad bills and false checks and counterfeit credit cards comes under them, as does the protection of the president. That's what attracted me to this. It was a kaleidoscope of various types of crime, from the importance of the country at stake to a $50 bad check.
Crazy asshole!
I have found that the nature of cops and criminals is very similar. They understand each other's lingo as though they're brethren. And even the good cops are guys who are walking a very fine line most of the time.
U.S. Secret Service. I'm arresting this guy for counterfeit.
It was a lot of fun to have a badge and a gun and be this character who, because he's got a badge and a gun, he's not only is he above the law, he's above life and death in his head. It really was an amazing, intoxicating experience for me. I mean, I got along with Billy great. I found him to be brilliant, fast, funny. It was a real joy to do this stuff. I learned a tremendous amount from Billy, not just about acting or filmmaking, but about how to operate in this bizarre business and how to survive it.
Willem had done maybe a couple of movies. He had a couple of movies in his belt. Petersen and I had done virtually nothing. And he was fantastic with us, man, patient and just there for us in a really positive way and in a really creative way. And because he is in touch with that whole world, the good, the bad, and the ugly of that world, he was a tremendous source of information for us.
It was really a run and gun, shoot from the hip, fast break sort of offense that we were playing in that movie that Billy guided us through.
We started off with a $6 million budget, and everyone took pretty low salaries. You know, it was kind of a common knowledge that this was not a big Exorcist-type budget.
I wanted to make an independent film, let's put it that way. And I wanted to do it with guys who knew how to work quickly, like Robbie Mueller, who was the director of photography, who had worked with Wim Wenders, the German director.
All right, Bill.
Most of our crew was kind of non-union because Robbie Mueller chose his own crew and he wasn't in the union. But it wasn't really to save money. It was just that's a crew that Billy wanted because it was a hit and run, you know. It wasn't a soundstage movie. We shot everything practical on the streets or in the whatever buildings that he wanted to shoot in.
Turn!
The fact that Billy shoots quickly and the fact that he will often use the first take really helped because there was a feeling often of flying by the seat of your pants, which was a good thing. It gave it an immediacy, I think, that helps the film.
Cut. Good.
A cut.
First of all, let me say, I don't like rehearsing at all. But I would set up a situation where they thought I was rehearsing, and then I'd say, all right, that's it, cut, let's move on. And they say, what? They thought it was rehearsal. It was a take.
He was always rolling on rehearsals or whatever, you know, just in case he got stuff he wanted to use.
Later, Alvarez. Next time you can make a jump with me.
I remember doing a rehearsal shot where we walk out of the bar. We weren't even thinking about it. We didn't think we were even having to do it. Next thing I know, the scene was over. He used the whole shot. He knew what he wanted. He knew what he got in the shot. He knew how he was going to use it later. So he didn't have to come in and do all this, you know, well, we better get this, and we better get this, and we better get this. He just said, that's it, we got it, we're out of here.
I believe in spontaneity. That's what I want to see in a performance. And I have found in my experience that the best takes I get are the ones I didn't tinker with at all. We talked about it, the actors were properly cast, they knew what they were doing, they went out and did it.
Federal agent, excuse me. Ma'am, I'd like to see the bills that man just handed you, please.
U.S. Secret Service!
Hey, hold it, man, where are you going?
The airport sequence was shot in the Bradley at the International Airport. Billy Petersen wanted to get through the crowd, so the best way for him to do is to jump on the tram things that run both ways. And that's what you're not supposed to do.
Billy comes over to me and he goes, you know, the airport officials are here. They've told us that you can't do that. In fact, they're gonna throw us out of here if we try to do that. And I said, Billy, that thing's that's great. We gotta do that, it's great. He goes, yeah, I agree. So, I'm gonna say we're rehearsing, but I'm gonna have Robbie and the other guy roll footage on this. And if it just so happens that you forget and jump up there anyway, well, you know, what can we say? Then, of course, they were all down on us. They were screaming and yelling. Billy's like, well, he did it. I didn't, you know, I didn't tell him to do it. I told him not to do it. Why did you do that? And again, that's what was great about working with Billy, because it, you know, it was all about getting what you had to get.
Okay, bring them all back to one.
Good.
For me, since I was, you know, I had this double thing of being an artist and a criminal, he really wanted to get me painting. I think that was important because it rooted that character's whole sensibility. It was almost more important to investigate him as an artist than as a criminal. And this whole idea of making the money to support the art, to destroy the art, it's a pretty interesting stew.
That was one of my favorite sequences in the movie, though. The whole setup of Willem as a counterfeiter. He blows on the metal sheet. So fantastic, that sequence. I thought that sequence was magnificent. Because, you know, it looks so incredibly authentic. And that is where you gotta go, bravo, Billy Friedkin, man, for getting in touch with the people who could get you that close to the real thing.
I love that sequence. It's so beautiful. And you realize how easy it is. And on the other hand, how it is an art. The whole counterfeiting montage in the movie is so precise because we got some guys that knew how to do that. We didn't ask questions, but I think they even did time for doing it.
Billy wanted it as realistic as possible, and how you make money from the very beginning to the end of making the money. We got a hold of a, I guess you can call him a consultant, and the consultant did all the real intricate work, putting the ink in and doing the little touches, and then Willem came in and did that also. He made over $1 million worth of money, and there was only three things wrong with this money. Obviously the paper and two small little other things.
It was never meant to be passed, and it never meant to be done anything but burned. You didn't really want to burn a whole bunch of real $20 bills, but you couldn't have it printed only on one side because as you threw it in, you'd see the back was white. So we actually printed on both sides, which I think that's where you cross the line.
Not bad at all. Not bad.
We were out in the desert printing money, and there was a real tension when we heard some helicopters go overhead. Because I think the laws on counterfeiting are so tight that if someone really wanted to bust us, they're right on the spot. We would have all been in real trouble.
After we shot the scenes, I burnt almost $1 million so it wouldn't get out. But you know how on a set sometimes somebody got a hold of a few bucks, and that's how things go down.
Somebody on the set took the bills home and had a teenage son. And he and a friend took the bills and went off to a grocery store and tried to buy some Hostess Twinkies or something. And they offered the guy behind the counter a one-sided 20. Within 5 minutes, the store manager had the Treasury Department there. And they grabbed these kids. Where'd you get this money? I got it from my dad. Where'd he get it? Boom, up pops the name of our property master, Barry Bettig, who was in charge of the counterfeit money.
The Secret Service got kind of upset. So about 10:30 at night, they came at my house banging on the door and said they wanted to see me downtown. Well, that one time went into six times. I came back to the set one day and I said, Billy, Jesus, this is the sixth time I've been down to the federal building. He says, listen, next time you go down there, tell them to either book you or let you go. And I said, what do you mean book me?
That's just Billy. I mean, he doesn't bend to certain authority. And that was an authority figure that he wasn't about to give in to.
And there are people like Masters who spend their life making counterfeit money and then they go to jail and they get out. And,
this is something Pankow and I have been working on in our off days here at Malibu.
it's just
the front side, you know, but as soon as we get this figured out, then we'll work on a backside.
Okay, you're both under arrest. And whoever the studio printer that was is through. I'm taking it with me. I'm taking it back to the office.
It's all right, I got more. One of the tremendous aspects about Billy Friedkin is how collaborative he is as a director. How he brings everybody in, the actors, and says, okay, we're in this together. Let's tell it together.
He called Billy Petersen and myself to go down to Ruthie's house in San Pedro. So we were going to actually have rehearsal. So I was very excited. I thought, my God, this is a film where I'm actually getting a rehearsal, not just a table read through. We went down to San Pedro. Bill came with us. We drove down there, and we get into the house, which was like perfect. It was just the most perfect set. And to get to live in your set, to get to actually experience that, really helps your character develop so well. So then Bill Friedkin said to Billy and myself, he says, well, I'm going to lunch. I'll see you guys in a couple hours. You work on it. And he left. And it was just so wonderful. It was like we looked at each other and say, okay, let's get to work.
Can I ask you something?
Sure.
What would you do if I stopped giving you information?
The films that move me the most are the ones where the performances seem timeless, where it looks like the camera was just peeking in, just happened to be there while this stuff was taking place. And so I told the actors to make it as real as possible. Make it real.
Well, there was a lot of edgy things about that movie. And again, it's a question of trust, you know, and I think Billy had all of our trust at all times. So that when he said, you know, look, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, or this, there was no argument against it. The only argument you would come up with is, I feel uncomfortable, and that's the actor getting in the way.
Billy Petersen and I trusted each other to make that choice, and we trusted Bill. When you feel trusted as an actor, you know you can fly. It gives you absolutely magnificent wings, because you know you can try something and you're not going to be made fun of.
Billy's got a nose, you know, and if something changes and he thinks it's going to an interesting place, he'll ride it out. I've seen him chase down instincts, you know, and have it take them to real interesting places.
This way. Let's go. Let's take you over here.
Your feet over there.
He creates the ingredients and then wants something to happen.
And then you'll be able to reach for the thing.
He sets up every shot. It's not like it's arbitrary shots. It's like he lines it up, sets it up with the DP, whether it's a dolly shot or whether it's a crane shot or whether it's a close-up or medium or wide. His eye is right there to set it up.
And then you continue looking.
You know, he never changes setups and moves around or hunting for a setup or, God, I don't know where to put the, you know, he knows exactly where he's going to put the camera and exactly what he wants, which is beneficial to everybody on the crew.
I get all the taste, brother. Yo.
I love you, Jeff.
What are you doing in my crib?
You sent two assholes to do Cody, and they blew it.
Action, Ernest.
The scene where we go to the house, and I kind of surprise them, that was some serious fighting in there. That was a really incredible ass-kicking going on there.
We're rolling. Action!
God, motherfucker! God damn it!
He wanted it nasty.
Come here!
He wanted to take the lamps and take the cords and use what was there. Not to make these guys look like they were professional fighters, but they had an instinct or two about how to kill somebody. God damn it!
We're going to have to follow him down.
Okay,
but I want to be tight on his face and see him crumble into us. Okay? Robert, just clear the front for a second, please. Willem can relax.
Our goal was to, you know, jump on it and not be inhibited by it at all. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been the same movie. I remember at one time Billy saying, look, I don't want marks. I don't want them to hit marks. I want them to do what they do and you capture it.
Come on out of there. This is not a mark. There are no marks. Now! Down! Beautiful. Okay, clean them up. Woo! Nice.
You know, there was a lot of times where he just left the cameras going on us to see what would happen. And we just never stopped until somebody said stop. You know, if we didn't hear stop, we just kept making our own movie.
Over the chain.
There's a scene where I come out of the car, we got the guy, and they had one of these Halliburton things where the money's supposed to be. But they thought the scene was going to end before we got to the place where I was going to beat the thing up against the abutment. Well, nobody said cut, so I just kept pounding the thing. I figured I had the one that was locked. It was never going to break.
I just let Petersen keep going. And lo and behold, he smashed the briefcase so hard that the lock broke. And you saw that there was nothing in the briefcase except a phone book.
That's very funny.
Nobody said stop. So we just went right on. You know, we grabbed the guy, kicked him, threw him in the dirt, dragged the belt off of him. And I think you see it in the movie, there's a life to it that is real, because it was real.
Get your pants down.
Let me get your fucking pants down. Let's get the fuck out of here.
Get your pants down.
It just played out. And it's a fantastic moment. It kept them in the reality.
You had to be ready to go as far as you could go with it.
You all right?
Oh, Christ.
You hoped they stop it before somebody got hurt.
Get out of here. Come on. Come on.
The chase scene was one of our last things to shoot. We were definitely going to go over budget and over schedule, and it took us 6 weeks to shoot the one scene. We were going to continue to shoot until he got what he wanted.
We had done all the principal photography, and then all of a sudden, we were a really stripped-down unit. We had no trucks coming with us, no wardrobe, no makeup. It was 40 stunt guys, Friedkin and Pankow and me. We were going all over L.A., blocking off streets and just spinning out.
Yeah, it's perfect.
You don't need a lot of people to shoot a chase, because when you're shooting a chase, it's one shot at a time, maybe with multiple cameras from different angles, but one shot at a time.
And these are all the stunt drivers that we're going to be having working on the show.
What are their names? Richard Ellis, Bobby Bass,
David Ellis, Dick Zeiker.
He's out of town.
And my name's Buddy Joe Hooker, yeah.
He says, you know, if we can come up with a chase that's better than the French Connection, then it'll be in the movie. If we do something that isn't, it won't be in the movie. And I believed him.
Let's just say this, if we've got a set of...
I like to do a lot of diagramming myself. I mean, for big chase sequences and stuff, the way I see them best and the way that I can explain them to people best is diagramming them. Overviews of who goes where and what's happening and camera positions.
And as he's crossing, then I want you to cross. So when we're coming with the camera, we see this kind of thing.
The chase requires a lot of cutting to be made to work. Actions and reactions, points of view. It's like knitting. It's painstaking. It's knit one and purl two.
First, there was all the stuff leading up to the freeway. We did a lot of it ourselves.
I was able to do a lot of the driving stuff, you know? And I wanted to do all of it. You know, I got to the point where it was much more fun to be doing the stunts than it was to be doing any of the acting stuff, you know? If you're driving the car that fast, it's happening. Poor Pankow. The blood would just drain out of his face every morning when he would find out what I was going to be doing with him in the back seat.
It was not lost on me that the car chase, the last 5 weeks, were shot at the end of the movie. I mean, something happens to one of us, they still got a movie.
We've seen all the movies. Most of them, you just go, hey, that doesn't happen. But to do real stuff and still make it work, that's a challenge.
The whole thing with the train, just being a part of that whole thing was just amazing, just to see how it all got put together.
He'll go around the train, and we'll lose him in that angle. You know, catch the train, pass it. Then he won't go through the fence until we move the cameras over here, down there. I just figured out the MacGuffin. Once you hit the riverbed and you're out of this thing and you think you're out, all of a sudden two guys come barreling straight at you.
Oh,
and they
man.
Start coming at you. Then you turn and you're out of that, and some guy starts firing out the window.
That's crazy.
Yeah, so everywhere you go, it'll be like a nightmare. They just come at you. And that's what forces you on the wrong way freeway.
I thought, what have I not seen? Well, I haven't seen a car on a freeway traveling against traffic. If we can pull this off, this is gonna be very hairy.
Going this way.
The deal is, the entrance we went onto was an actual entrance ramp where they just put a do not enter sign up, and we go. They have all the stunt drivers coming off the entrance. Now, what Friedkin did to make it even more confusing was everybody else was going the wrong way. If you look at that movie, it's like England. The oncoming traffic is basically in the wrong lane, all of it. So it's really confusing.
Billy likes some radical stuff, and he'll call for the heaviest stuff you can give him, but he wants it to be safe. We had designed this swivel car that was hydraulic that you could pull behind the camera car. So when they're going through traffic, we could place the actors believably in that and make the audience think that they were there. And at a given point, they hit a button and the car goes whoo, back like this, and it's them. There's no faking it or no screens and all that stuff.
Get out of the way! Get out of there!
It's choreographed, but there's a tremendous margin for error. And you know, you hit somebody going 25 and they're going 25 and you hit them head on. It's like going 50 miles an hour into a wall. I mean, that's a hit.
I made the mistake of telling him, hey, you know, when they're on the freeway, why don't we jackknife this truck? And he goes, great, great, put it in, let's do it. And then I'm going, how in the world do we do it? Up to that time, I don't think there had ever been anything like that, a truck jackknifing and squashing cars and the whole thing. When they locked up the tractor and the trailer brakes, we had a cable going from the back of the truck to this big four-wheel drive. We had cars all stuck in between them too, so we could lock it up and just pull the trailer right around and squish them as much as we wanted, and bingo.
About a year after the movie opened, I was at a coffee shop And I'm sitting next to a guy who's an undercover cop. And he says, you're John Pankow. And I go, yeah. He goes, oh, man. He goes, I can't believe I'm hanging with you. He goes, I'm an undercover cop, NYPD. And he goes, I have to tell you, that was so unbelievably true to life, your complete state of panic.
What are we gonna do?
He said, I have been in it. I have been shot at. I have been in chases. That is exactly what you feel. It is just blind panic.
Are you out of your fucking mind, son?
I had no idea where I was gonna go with the script while we were filming. Here's this guy, this Secret Service agent, who's defying death every time he goes out and who throws caution to the wind. And it seemed to me that inherently, this agent was setting himself up to die.
Turn around. Right there, asshole.
I thought, you know, how am I gonna end this thing and not do some, you know, phony tacked on ending?
Freeze it up, pal.
Originally, the screenplay was written that Vukovich would die in that locker room scene. And Billy said, what do you think if we kill Billy Petersen instead of Johnny Pankow? I said, wow, that would be killing your star, wouldn't it? He said, yeah, but it would sure be a twist. And I said, well, I think maybe you should try to shoot it both ways. And he said, ah, let's shoot it one way. We'll kill him.
Having Chance go down in this movie is, I remember thinking that that's just such a great idea because it just doesn't happen. It just never happens. You never see the protagonist go down.
You can't do this to me!
With probably less than 10 minutes left, the star of the film gets killed. I thought, well, the audience certainly isn't prepared for this, but then when it happens, they will get it. The idea that if you live by the sword, you're gonna die by the sword.
You know, this is a guy who was never gonna live long anyway. You know, if it hadn't have been in the locker room that night, it would have been out on a highway or some parachute jump. You know, he was not long for the world, Chance, any more than Masters was.
The agent and the counterfeiter, these are guys driving toward suicide. And so, you live by fire, you die by fire. And you always have to be open to the unexpected. The real Chance is dead, and his young partner becomes him. He isn't really him, but he has now assimilated all of the characteristics, attitude, and even the dress of his mentor.
You're working for me now.
And so, in a final counterfeit moment, Vukovich becomes Chance.
Let's live dangerously.